I always had a thirst for martial arts. It's kind of ironic because I used to watch TV a lot, and I saw this one master, and it just happened to be Ed Parker. And it was very ironic when I finally got to the school and found out that he was the Grand Master. I was really pleased that it was his style that I was studying. It was about 1964. I really, really wanted to study martial arts. I would study anything I could find, a little wrist lock, or some kid at school would have something, and he would show me, and we'd make up a little skit, and we'd do a demonstration. We'd have a counter for it, and we'd have fun. I walked into Chuck Sullivan and Ed Parker School in Inglewood. It was the original Inglewood Ed Parker Chuck Sullivan School, and it was late 1963, early 64. And I started studying Kenpo with Chuck Sullivan and Ed Parker at the Inglewood Ed Parker School. Well, there was a guy there called Crazy George, and he was the basics instructor. And Mr. Sullivan didn't get off work till about 6:30 or 7 and get there. And Crazy George, or George Quinones is his name, was the basics instructor. That first class, I thought we were going to die. He would taught us how to block, and he said, "Now, have you got it?" I had no idea that he was going to punch us in the nose and could stop this close to our nose. We had to block to get out of the class. We did lots of fighting and lots of techniques. Forms were like not secondary, but we didn't do them every night. We were more interested in reality training. Danny Inosano had just gotten his black belt from Chuck Sullivan and left to go with Chuck Sullivan and Ed Parker at the school, and left to go with Bruce. Well, it just so happens that Danny Inosano had a flat top and Chuck Sullivan had the barber shop. Everybody went to Chuck's barber shop for a haircut. So Danny came back every 2 weeks to get a haircut at Mr. Sullivan's barber shop and told us exactly what Bruce was doing. And then Chuck would tell Danny what we were doing, and he'd go back and tell Bruce, and we went back and forth. So it was kind of exciting. Well, I love my Kenpo, and I was a well-rounded fighter, and I really liked it. I was just in thirst of something else. And back in the day, you didn't go out and study another style and expect to come back. Okay, but Chuck Sullivan was open-minded. Danny Inosano was a personal friend of his. I ran into Richard Bastillo at a Harley shop. I had a Harley shop myself. I built custom choppers. Richard had a Jeet Kune Do shirt on and said, I said, "I know Jeet Kune Do," and I showed him a hook tear punch, and he laughed at me. And I said, "I'll build your Harley if you teach me Jeet Kune Do," and that's how we got started. I went over to Danny Inosano's school. It was the IBM Academy in Torrance, California, when it first opened. And I built Richard a Harley, and he started to teach me. And I studied privately with Danny, and I studied group classes with Danny. And then Jerry Potique, he just happens to be French, and I'm French. He liked me, and he took me aside. And I spent about 10 to 15 years studying privately with Jerry. For my Jeet Kune Do training, I really enjoyed the Jeet Kune Do training. I've studied a lot of different styles, but it really helped me understand a lot of things that I already knew. What I've taken from my Jeet Kune Do training is Jeet Kune Do, or JKD, they would consider classical karate people front classical committed blockers. The sensitivity and the dissolving of the front hand is very important. I like to give that to my people. As I throw a right punch, he blocks. I like to dissolve and roll around it. Mr. Parker would do a thing called reroute. He would come in and move around and hit. It was very, very similar. There's a lot of similarities in the art. But the sensitivity and the dissolving and the energy in this, again, that rolling around and feeling it, and just feeling it, works so nice to be able to get around once you've thrown something and you run into an obstruction or a block. Okay? We have a drill that I've take. It's called Bung Sao Drill. It's just a block, trap hit, block, trap hit. This is a two-man cooperative drill. It's an actual JKD drill. Switch. Slow down. Which just gets you used to flowing a little bit with this. Now, the end result is if I pull on this hand, he'll pull me back. If I push on this hand, he opens. I can scientifically open and close you by pushing buttons. When he pulls back, boom, it allows me to come in and trap. Okay? It works well. Well, I first started studying judo, jiu-jitsu, and aikido because that's all there was in those times. You look around, there wasn't, you know, Kenpo schools or taekwondo schools on every corner. There was a sign that said judo or aikido or ikidu ikido, you know, which is sounds kind of funny today, but that means joint lock. You know, and since then I've probably studied 15 different methods of it, different angles and different people with different principles and concepts, and it's very interesting. Well, Kenpo done by Mr. Parker at 240 pounds, and done by Mr. Sullivan at 140 pounds is a different animal. Some people say the Kenpo techniques are a little difficult to do, not for Mr. Parker. But you try to teach a little lady in Florida that's 110 pounds, it's a little different. Things had to be altered, things had to be changed. And Mr. Sullivan changed it all to fit his style and size. And as we came through, it was like a custom suit of clothes. He'd say, you're a little not as heavy as Mr. Parker, so here's how you move to make up for it. And we adapted and fit. It was still an individual art, you know. I don't even like the testing today when they test everybody in a group. This is an individual art, you know. You should be brought up on your own attributes. Everybody is something different, you know. We have a certification program that goes with the Karate Connection. And when you get your black belt with us, you've really not mastered anything. You've passed a sequence of tests. It takes probably about 6 more years to master it. And they say, well, what do you do for your second degree and your third degree? Master the material that you've already learned. You know, so we go back and we like to put reality into play. We took Kenpo and we tried to make it real. We didn't just do the techniques in the air. We'd do it with a rear escape and then somebody coming from the front, somebody coming from both sides. Then we made up drills that we were attacked from both right and left flank, just past your point of vision, straight ahead and at pie slice. So if you've got a good technique that works here and it works here, it doesn't work over here. You had to either develop your left side, just like a good headlock. You got a real good headlock for your right side. What if it gets you in a headlock on the left side? There's some techniques that you must develop. And I'm right-handed and I love my right block, but most people throw a right overhead right punch. My left hand better be taking care of that side. So we had to make it real. We tried to work with it. We came up with scenarios and different things. We oftentimes would fight in the dojo around chairs and furniture with the lights kind of out. Then we got carried away, so to speak. We fought in the alley at dusk with loose clothes on. And then we invited other karate schools over at dusk and fought them in the alley with loose clothes on. And we had some good times, you know. We used to hear this, they're here. What do you mean they're here? Beep, beep, beep. The International Championships was put on by Ed Parker. And out of the Inglewood Ed Parker School, we won every internationals. Steve Sanders was the winningest fighter of all times, and it evolved. And if you beat some of the people at the tournament, they would come back to your dojo all year long. Chuck Norris and the boys were at the school every 2 weeks. And he was an excellent practitioner, but he wanted to see what was getting him, what we were sticking him with, and he wanted a counter for it. And so quite frequently, Chuck and the boys would come over, and quite a few of the other schools would come over. Right, the other influence that we've taken back into Kenpo is the joint lock flow, which is Aikido or Jiu-Jitsu, which is hand immobilization and things. The rule is we're not allowed to grab somebody's hand with both hands unless I've stunned or hurt him. Otherwise, I'm going to get poked in the eyes, kicked in the groin. With the old saying, you don't put all your apples in one basket. So as he steps in and blocks, this is boom. I can back knuckle. I come into my wrist lock, boom. I switch from outside, from inside to outside. I go into the old arm bar, come back in, take down. We like to come around, I lock. I like to break the arm there. Now I'll put the striking arc, which is Kenpo, back into it, and you see a little bit of what I'm talking. I'm gonna do it very slow for you so you can see it as it comes in. Now, bicep striking, radial nerve, crack them. As I come down to here, boom. Inside to outside, I'm gonna break the arm here now, pull him into the knee, grab here, and as he goes down, and as he slices the face, right into my arm and lock, break. If you were there in the beginning, you knew that we were the original guys. Chuck Sullivan was here, and he probably had 15 techniques that he loved and did. Some of the techniques didn't seem to work as well, like I said, because of the size difference and stuff. And if you weren't at one of the main schools, I tell people the difference between Kenpo on the West Coast and the East Coast is day and night. If you go to Europe, it's like really different. It's how many times has he been to a seminar? In reality, we were there with Mr. Parker all the time. And some of the techniques, like I said, were a little more difficult and some of them weren't. But Mr. Parker told us that 10 trains left in the middle of the night and then he chased them for the rest of his life. He said, I went to Texas, you got 10 schools. He said, the only thing I recognized was the names. He said, unfortunately, it's been changed and everybody's got their own interpretation of it. So when we tried to put it together, we wanted to make you study Kenpo for all those wonderful principles and concepts. Well, we wanted you to be able to get them all. If you're studying from a guy that's studying from a guy that still hasn't got them, And the old principle of having a blue belt teach the basics at the private lessons, he still doesn't have his stances right. You know, at our seminars, Senior Grandmaster Chuck Sullivan teaches the basics because he's the most qualified. And we really wanted it to be. So we put 55 techniques together with every principle and concept, every move, bite, scratch in the Ed Parker system. We wanted you to have them. We wanted you to get them. Because if some reason you didn't learn the whole system, somebody didn't interpret them properly and understand them, you weren't going to get them. And we love them. And we wanted to share them with people. If you'd like to learn Form 4 or one of the beautiful forms after that, have a good time. But we wanted to make sure you had everything you needed to take care of business. And like I said, unless you have it all, people get to black belt with us and say, we're a master. You're not a master. You've passed a sequence of tests. Second degree, what do? Nothing. We want you to go back and master the material now that you have all the material. Now that you have it all and you have black belt eyes, go back and redo it. You go, oh, wow, now I see what he means. Oh, yeah. So 55 techniques is a big gulp to get it all right because we ask for a high level of integrity. We make sure everything's there and working. And then, like I said, we try to work it into drills and make it reality. We want to do it spontaneously. We want to do it with the right breathing. If you'd like to be a certified instructor and use our diplomas and have us sign them and sanction what you're doing, we need to see a student at each level that you've taught, not using the DVDs or the videos. And then we give you a lesson saying, John, welcome. And Jim, thank you for being the certification student. Jim, you're doing that a little wrong. John, are you and the rest of the students doing that? We make corrections on the whole school, and we dial it back in, and we try to get it and break it down all the way through so that it's done properly. One of the other styles we were introduced to was taught to us by Chuck Sullivan. Chuck Sullivan, in the very beginning, Ed Parker had James Wing Wu with him, and he taught a longhand Chinese Kung Fu style, which strikes with the fore knuckles and the back knuckles, which is a little different if you've never seen it. And anything we can do to win a fight works with the old long hand with the blocks, the old the long hand Chinese works real well, especially if you've never seen it before or have never had it used on you. It's a little different than a straight. We also studied a little bit of the Japanese art, the bonsai run, which is the palm exploding knee, shuffle, punch, kick. If you can't do an opposite kick punch, which is, you have to practice it, it's not easily learned, it's okay, it's real hard to stop. So from here, boom, boom, boom. One of my favorite fighters is Benny the Jet. Benny likes to use it. He does a foot shuffle combination before he uses it. I love it. I've got some vintage footage of Ed Parker teaching him a little of that too coming in. But the Japanese bonsai run, which is totally committed, works really well too. These are some of the things that we brought home with us. The benefits I got was self-restraint and discipline and goal-orientated. It made me goal-orientated. It made me want to be in competition. It made me want to work hard and achieve the next level. You know, when you get the one belt and you get your next belt, there's a lot of different things it does for people. I was a pretty wild kid, and somebody needed to tame me down a little bit. And if I acted goofy or did something funny in class, I'd get that look from my instructor. And as much as I respected and loved my instructors, that I didn't want that look again. I wanted to calm down. One of the things, you know, my parents took me there because I wanted to go. I had very wonderful parents. They supported me in everything I wanted to do. And martial arts can give you, like Bruce Lee said, he talks about it through life. It's not just the martial arts. You know, he looks at something from my point of view, from your point of view, from over there. Well, there's a points of life now. You look at it and evolve and analyze things. Today I'd like to share with you a little bit of my trapping. I have three different schools of thought on trapping, and I'd like to share them with you. The first one is JKD, closing the distance, a front hand trap. Rudy, please step in. Okay, stance please. We're going to come in and we're going to pin the front hand, move in over the top, and hit. Okay, that's the basic way it's done. You can shoot a hand low to draw a hand low. You come in over the top and hit. Okay, well, we've been doing this for a lot of years. Mr. Parker taught me to go a little deeper. He said, why are you trapping with your front hand? Why are you hitting here? Why don't you break the nose like I taught you and tear down the face? Let the forearm do the trapping. So that's the way I like to do the front entry. And a lot of times to close the distance, there's three or four ways to close the distance. We do a foot replacement, knife, step, scrape, stomp, pat, hit, okay? So from here, pendulum step, boom, come up, hit, come in and hit. Now, you could guideline up here and shoot this way, but I like to come in here. When you get the reaction, his hand will come up, then you go two, three, step in, and do whatever you want to do. But that's the line of entry to open, the front hand trap. Okay, again, I go hit the arm, I come a little deeper and hit here, to my circle, boom, the reaction, that's the basic opening. Two, three, do whatever you want to do, step up, take down, buckle, do whatever you'd like to do. Try that, I think you'll really enjoy it. Well, I think mixed martial arts is great. You know, having some of everything is fantastic, but the idea that you're a master of this and a master of that because you did it for 6 months or so, my answer to you is go down to the Los Angeles gym and watch the boxers. Nobody hits them in the head 9 times. You can't even hit a boxer. So if these guys say, I'm a boxer, I'm this, they need a little more, and they're getting better. They're getting better at everything. You see them, they started out a little weak, and you see their next fight, they're better at everything. The individual disciplines, it's not easy to learn them. And so to say you learned everything and put it all in a bag and shake it up, you know, some people can, some people can't. In the beginning, Danny and Asano and Bruce's boys, they didn't want you to have it all. They would teach you too much in a lesson, and you wouldn't get much of it. You'd be writing it on your arm, and you know, some people had a photostatic memory and fooled them, though, and learned a little more, but you know. I love where it's going. We love what it's doing. The Gracies came to our school. We were one of the very first people to challenge us, and they came to our school. And I had no idea that they were the brothers, and it was kind of funny. And they went right down the street and choked out Ralph Alegria. And we started studying it. We said, hey, there's another element, and we better learn it. You know, ground fighting has its place. I love the counters. I love the chokes. We practice in everything that we do a flow now. We've been teaching so many years at our seminars. They came the first year and we taught them a singular move. They come back the next year expecting more. So we put a couple more moves together and a flow. We have joint lock flows. We have trapping flows. And we also have ground fighting flows. If I miss an arm bar, I go right to the choke. And if I miss that choke, I go right to my next move. But again, we go back to hitting. We want to hit. We're doing hitting in between everything. So it's a whole different point of view, whole different, you know, I want to hit. Okay. And I get a big kick out of people that learn trapping. Trapping, while you're hitting, is to clear the path to continue hitting. It's not a separate art. It's while you're hitting. Most people are into self-defense. That's one of the things I teach at my seminar. So I'm teaching them, let's quit stepping back and block. And you can only take so many punches before it's going to hurt you. Let's step back in and return fire. Let's talk about hitting. Hitting. I know you're a nice person and you want it for self-defense, but let's take the animal. I didn't study martial arts for self-defense. I wanted to fight. I was so happy the first night they said, now you can do whatever you want. Really? Don't have to go left side. Don't have to go right side. I can do whatever. Then I found out I couldn't do most of what I wanted to do. And then the practice became how to close that distance. The second trap that I'd like to show you is taught to me by Ed Parker. And he loved to use his whole body weight. He used his whole body weight. And to close the distance this time, he'd use a rear cross. Now, this is my center of gravity or my center line. It runs directly down through me and out of my spine. And if I'm standing where he was, if I occupy his center line, he can't be standing there. So I'm going to move my whole body weight in and take it. Mr. Parker likes to cancel height, width, and depth zones all at the same time. And using his whole body weight, he would cross in with a rear cross and a strike, okay? As deep as he could. One, two. And immediately, to keep this hand out of his groin, he would usually either break it or drop the knees and drop some other kind of ending, whatever he decided to do. All right, so again, we're going to use our whole body weight. We're going to come in. We're going to commit ourselves. We usually throw it. Now, I could be spinning in with a back knuckle. Catch this. Boom. Two. Three. Okay? And again, this last position I'm in, I'm posturing. The better posture I have, the better my back's arched, the closer my center line is, the harder he goes down. Okay, one more time. Again, from here, I throw a back knuckle. Now, there's two kinds, actions faster than reaction. So a lot of times I'll throw the back knuckle and I'll get him. I'll get him. It hits him. And then his hand comes up. And then it's mine. And if you're trying to grab this way, it's more difficult. If you're coming down for the grab. It's easier to get. And Mr. Sullivan likes to grab the garment a lot more than he does the arm, because you grab the arm, it can be opened up. He grabs the garment, he gets his hand wadded up, you're not going to get away from him. He's got that garment. It makes a big difference. But for this one, again, you can come in and throw this, two, three. And again, if I come in here, I can come into here if I like. Do whatever I want to him, all the way to the ground. I don't like to go to the ground and headbutt him on the ground. I want to take care of it while we're standing up. My idea of a ground fight is he goes to the ground, I go home. I run his knee into the concrete. Bang, boom. He's going to the ground. I'm not going to the ground. I've got other things to do. Bruce Lee's art was my favorite of all the arts that I've studied outside of Kenpo. And because of the sensitivity, karate guys are committed front hand blockers. And Danny would dissolve, and I mean, Bruce would just dissolve and roll off of it. It'd give you a whole new insight into, you know, movement, secondary. Mr. Parker had a favorite saying, he'd like to reroute. When in doubt, reroute. And he'd throw a punch at you and curve it and hit you. And Bruce would trap it and roll and hit you. And then dissolve and move around it. So it's helped me in understanding a little more sensitivity. It's not such a classical cooperative robot. That's what they would call us. That's what the Jeet Kune Do guys call a classical karateka, classical cooperative robot. And they even have a picture of a tombstone buried, if you've seen them. You know what I mean? Leave it alone. It's classical. But a lot of people try to imitate Bruce, which is not a good idea, because he was 140-some pounds or 150 pounds, and he could move. If you're standing the way he does, that's why I always revert back to my Kenpo stance. When studying JKD and boxing at the Inosano academies and things, I always had a big advantage over all the other fighters, because my groin was protected because of my Kenpo stance, because of my knee checking, because of my basics. So it's really, really helped me. And I love the Jeet Kune Do for the sensitive, and there's some drills that go with it, and I do teach that. I teach three styles of trapping. I teach Bruce Lee's, I teach Ed Parker's, and I teach Chuck Sullivan's. Ed Parker uses whole body weight and trap like you've never seen anybody trap before. Chuck would grab a hold of you and actually finish you with his trapping. Bruce would do the first touch and enter an entry, and then he'd let go. Everybody had a different approach. Parker would grab you and whole body weight with it and hit you. Chuck grab you, hit, and control. Bruce would open the line and come in. I also studied some jiu-jitsu and joint lock flow, and from many different people. Mitch Yamashita was my instructor at El Camino College, and I always look back to Mitch as being my original instructor, and he's just excellent. But you get a situation, you're working a nightclub or you're a professional bodyguard or somewhere, all the way to the nightclub I'm telling myself, don't hit. Okay, you've got to control people. You can't get in a situation where you're just, everything you do is punch somebody or poke them in the eyes. That doesn't work. You don't want to inflict that kind of damage. You want to control a situation. You want to calm it. You know, you're not there just to beat people senseless and, you know, stomp them. Kenpo is very violent, and you have to be careful. You hit somebody here, the ground comes up, does a lot of damage. So the joint lock flow really goes along nice with Kenpo too. But we're never allowed to grab someone unless we've stunned them, because you get hurt. You got both your hands, they can poke you, can do counters to you. So after a block and thing, we can do joint manipulation and come-alongs and things of that sort. So the joint lock, Aikido, wrist locks and all that, really a nice compliment to Kenpo. In the beginning, it was called Kenjutsu, and it came from that source too. And the third method of trapping is taught to me by my instructor, Chuck Sullivan. And I gotta tell you, I like that the best, because it actually seems to finish the fight, because he grabs and controls. Most people don't understand, when you're doing a takedown on somebody, don't go down, but when I'm doing a takedown, as I'm coming in, I should be hitting all the way to the ground. The fight's over. I must have hit him 9 times before he hit the ground. So my instructors did it. They didn't just hit me. They didn't just do a takedown on me. Boom, grab, step up, lock, boom, boom, boom. As I'm going down, I'm being hit. I'm being hit low when my elbow's down. And then he brings it up. He goes up. I start hitting him in the head. His hand goes up. I go back to the ribs. Boom, 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 boom. We're finishing. You finish the fight. Okay, so on this one, you do what kind of entry you want. A lot of times we step in and we might even kick this way just to stutter just for a second as I grab and come down in control, okay? Slide in, I check up with the knee and start hitting. Move away. You ride him. And you don't let him get away. You just ride him. The whole idea is ride him and beat him. Finish the fight. We used to be freestyling, and whenever my instructor decided that was the end of the match for the night, he would grab me, control me, and I'd go home and have these bumps, dents all the way up and down me, where I was hit, and there was no getting away from it, and there was no choice. You may pick out a style that interests you, and later on find out that it's not all that you thought it was, or this or that. You may pick a style because of the instructor, how much you like the instructor, how much you like the person himself. It's up to you to do a little homework, to look around a little bit. You need to find out what fits you, fits your situation. Why are you studying martial arts? You have to ask yourself that question. What's the bottom line? Why? You know, I'm a correctional officer. I work at the prison. You know, I'm a police officer. You know, a little different application on all of them. You just don't go out there and box them in the head. You know, you're going to study for the ring. Then you better get a little of this. You got to have some of that. You know, all I can say to them is, you know, do a little homework first. I like Chinese Kenpo. It's very well-rounded. I like our blocks and our stances and our protection better. And I go out and I always come back to my base, which was my Kenpo, and I love it. But like I said, I bring things home with me too.